welcome to the last talk in the session. So this talk is entitled On Symmetric Encryption with Distinguishable Decryption Failure. The paper is by Elena Bodyoleva, Jean-Paul De Gabriele, Kenny Patterson, and Martin Stamm, and Jean-Paul is giving the talk.
So this is joint work with Sacha Bodyoleva, Kenny Patterson, and Martin Stamm. My talk will consist of two main sections. I will start with some motivation. I will describe what distinguishable decryption failures are. And I will point out to a gap that they raise between theory and practice. And then as a proposed solution, I will propose the multiple error setting, which requires a change in the syntax and encryption schemes. And then, since this change in the syntax results in a different object, theoretically, we'll have to revise a bit of the theory that we know about in the encryption. Okay, so consider the following class of attacks. We have a sender, receiver, and adversary. So the sender, the adversary intercepts ciphertext from the sender. Let's call it the green ciphertext. And then the adversary is able to mold this green ciphertext into a new ciphertext, the blue ciphertext, and sends it over to the receiver. And by observing whether the receiver manages to successfully decrypt this blue ciphertext or not, the adversary is able to recover some information about the underlying plain text and the green ciphertext. And what makes these kind of attacks normally quite powerful is that the adversary is able to iterate over this procedure over and over. So he's able to obtain more ciphertext, let's say the orange ciphertext, and submit it again and recover more information by just knowing whether the ciphertext is valid or not. And by doing this over and over, he is able to recover the plain text underlying in the green ciphertext. Typical examples of these kind of attacks are Vahin-Bacher's attack on RSA and Vodnin-Spelling Oracle on CPC encryption. And when these attacks first appeared, they motivated us to require NCCA security. But as I will show, as I will describe shortly, NCCA security does not always guarantee security against this kind of attacks. And this is because, for example, during decryption, an algorithm might perform a number of checks, and if any of these checks fails, then the decryption fails. However, if the adversary is able to distinguish between which check failed, this can convey more information to the adversary. And such ability of this adversary being able to distinguish the exact decryption failure has enabled a number of attacks against, for example, TLS, DTLS, and IPsec. On the other hand, in the NCCA model, the adversary, due to the way that we describe symmetric encryption, or we specify symmetric schemes, the adversary only gets the same error symbol, regardless of the decryption failure that occurred. So he always gets the same symbol per. So this creates a gap between what the adversary is able to do in the security model and the CA, and what the adversary is able to do in practice. The common response that I usually get from the adversaries is that this is a flaw in the implementation, and it can easily be fixed by ensuring that errors are distributed in practice. However, this turns out not to be so trivial in practice, because first of all, let's remember that errors have a use in practice, right? They're useful for troubleshooting. They're there for a reason. Moreover, other side channels like timing side channels or the security protocol's interaction with layers above or below can reveal which decryption failed, or which test or which check in the decryption algorithm failed. And these things are hard to predict and to prevent in practice. On the other hand, it is very easy to account for these distinguishable decryption failure attacks, in theory, by just redefining the symmetric scheme to return multiple errors. So we just let the decryption algorithm return a message, either a message, or instead of one symbol, perp, we let that be a set of symbols, a set of error messages, which we denote by as perp. But since this, technically, the results in a different object, we need to revisit a bit the theoretical results that we know about symmetric encryption. And then just at the talk, I will do this. Like, I will just revisit some of the known results with you and see how these change in the multiple error setting. So let's start with the following relation that was proposed by Brian Nampernker and at the same time by Katz and Jones. So this says that if a scheme is NCPA secure and it satisfies ciphertext integrity, then the resulting scheme is also NCPA secure. So this relation and its simplicity provides a very simple way of achieving NCPA security in the symmetric setting. And it also turned out to be quite useful because NCText and NCPA by themselves guarantee strong confidentiality, which is NCCA, and also message authentication. So it became the target security notion for authenticated encryption. Later, in a work by Belayan, Pong, and Prempren in 2004, on their analysis on SSH, they extended this relation to the stateful setting. So now we have NCPA and stateful ciphertext integrity guarantee stateful NCCA. So these stateful notions, they are just strengthened variations of their normal counterparts, and that they also capture replay and reordering attacks. So these notions guarantee also security against replay and reordering attacks, which are very important in practice. And it can easily be shown that an encryption scheme that satisfies these notions must be stateful, and hence that's where the name comes from. So the first thing we ask is, do these relations hold in the multiple error setting? So do these relations still hold if we allow schemes to have multiple errors? And the answer to that is no. So we have the following separation, which assumes that if a pseudorandom function, if pseudorandom functions exist, then there exists a scheme which has multiple errors, and it is both NCPA and it satisfies NCText, but it is not NCCA secure. And similar separation is also hold for the stateful setting. We can prove the same separation for the stateful setting. As a technical note here, we will see shortly in a few slides that it is possible to extend the notion of ciphertext integrity in two main ways, which are very natural. And these separations hold irrespective of which notion we assume for ciphertext integrity. Okay, so given that these relations were quite useful in the past, can we obtain something similar in the multiple error setting? And that brings us to our next result. So we proved the following relation, that a new notion, which or relatively new, which is indistinguishability under chosen validity or under ciphertext validity attack, and ciphertext integrity imply NCCA. And informally, NCVA is just a strengthened variation of NCPA, where the adversary is additionally given access to a ciphertext validity oracle, which returns whether a ciphertext is valid, but no plaintext, or if the ciphertext is invalid, it returns the exact decryption error. Also here, in this relation, ciphertext integrity refers to the stronger variant that I will define soon. So we're only able to prove this relation assuming the stronger variant. And similar relations can also be obtained for other variants of NCCA security, that is, the stateful variant or indistinguishability from random bits. Okay, so here's how we can extend the ciphertext integrity for the multiple error setting. I will start by showing you the weaker variant, which we denote by NCText star. So the experiment goes as usual. We generate a key, do some initialization, And then we give the adversary access to two oracles, an encryption oracle and a try oracle. The encryption oracle behaves quite in a standard way, that is, it returns ciphertext and keeps a list of the ciphertext that it returns. The try oracle then, when it is given a ciphertext, it will return whether the ciphertext is valid or not. In addition, if an adversary is able to submit a ciphertext to the try oracle that was not previously output by the encryption oracle and is valid, then the adversary wins the game. So before showing you the stronger variant, note that here that the try oracle only reveals whether a ciphertext is valid or not. So the stronger variant is defined very similarly, except that now the try oracle also reveals whether the ciphertext is valid or not, but when it's invalid, it also returns the exact error symbol. So okay, the questions to ask are, obviously, one can easily see that in syntax implies the weaker notion of in syntax star, but it's not clear immediately whether the converse is true. Secondly, you might question whether the other relation that we obtained, that is in CVA and in syntax implying CCA, whether that still holds if we assume the weaker variant, or just because we're not able to prove it assuming the weaker variant doesn't mean that it doesn't hold, right? And both of these questions can be settled through the following non-trivial separation. So we show that given a scheme which has a sufficiently large vector space and is both in CVA secure and in syntax star secure, we can construct a multiple error scheme that is both in CVA and in syntax star, but not in CCA secure. So this immediately shows that in syntax star is a weaker variant, is strictly weaker than in syntax, and also shows that the relation can be proved assuming the weaker variant of in syntax. So the next thing we look at is a notion called in CCA 3. You might also know it under a different name. This was put forward by Rogoway and Shrimpton in 2006. And basically, it concisely compresses the two notions of CCA and syntax into a single notion. And this is defined as follows. So we define two games. In the first game, the adversary is given an encryption oracle and a decryption oracle. And in the second game, the adversary is given an encryption oracle which returns the encryption of a random message of the same size, and a decryption oracle which always returns perfect. So the thing we ask here is, can we extend this notion to the multiple error setting? And if so, what is the security that this notion guarantees in the multiple error setting? So the first is very easy to do. We simply change the definition to allow, so since now there's more than one single error message, we require that there exists an error message per knock in the space of messages, in the space of errors of the scheme, and that for all adversaries A, no adversary is distinguished between the two words. And in the two words, we now give the decryption oracle which always returns per knock. So this is a very natural way of extending the notion to the multiple error case. So then, let's look at what security this notion guarantees in the symmetric setting. So, we show that in CCA3 is equivalent to the combination of these three notions, which is in CPA, in syntax star, that is the weaker variant of ciphertext integrity, and a notion which we call error invariant. And informally, error invariant says that all invalid ciphertext that an adversary can come up with will generate the same error. So still the question remains whether this is a good notion. So then we show that in CCA3 implies in CVA and in syntax, and from the relations that we've obtained before, this implies in CCA security. So in CCA3 still guarantees strong confidentiality, which is in CCA, and it guarantees message authentication. So it is still a good notion for authenticating encryption, but maybe it is too strong, because it can be shown that in CCA3 is strictly stronger than the combination of in CVA and syntax. So the next thing we look at is a generic composition of authenticated encryption. So realizing authenticated encryption to generic composition. And this was first looked at by Bellarine and Bremper in 2000. And one of the main results of their work is that encrypt and MAC emerges as the preferred dynamic composition technique for obtaining the end-to-end encryption. And the reason being that for any encryption scheme which is MCP secure and any MAC which is strongly unforgeable, encrypt and MAC provides a scheme that is always results in a scheme that is MCP secure. And the same can be said about MAC then encrypt or encrypt and MAC. However, later or shortly after, Kravchuk showed that MAC then encrypt is also MCP secure when the encryption used is CBC mode or counter mode. So, for the case of CBC and the counter mode, which are the two that are mainly used in practice, at least as far as the general composition techniques go, we really don't have, or these papers don't tell us anything about, don't tell us much why encrypt and MAC with CBC or counter mode should be better than MAC then encrypt with CBC or counter mode. And however, in practice, it turns has been observed that encrypt and MAC was less prone to attack than MAC then encrypt when these, even when it's synthesized with the CBC or counter mode. So we believe that reconsidering generic composition through in the light of distinguished replication failures can provide new evidence of why encrypt and MAC is better than MAC then encrypt. So we consider an extended version of encrypt and MAC. We also include an encoding part to account for the pre-processing that is common in practice and practical schemes. So practical schemes normally include either padding or some kind of formatting, and that can be modeled by including an encoding part in the composition. And then we have the following theorem that says that for any multiple error encoding scheme, so that we allow any encoding scheme to return any number of encryption or any number of errors, and any encryption scheme which is MCP secure and has any number of errors as well, that is multiple error, and any MAC that is strongly unforgeable, the EEM composition yields a scheme which is MCP secure. So the good thing or the nice thing about this theorem is that security holds irrespective of the error behavior of both the encoding component and the encryption component. So this says that EEM is a very robust composition. That is, whatever encoding scheme you use, and irrespective of the error behavior of the encryption scheme, security still holds. And if we look at the example I gave before about attacks on SSL, IPsec, and that I mentioned, so I didn't present the attacks, and the TLS, these serve as counterexamples to show, for example, that a similar statement could be made about MAC, then encode, and encrypt. However, it may seem unfair that we don't allow the MAC to return multiple errors. But this can be justified as follows. First of all, MACs in practice are normally realized by having an attack component and the verify component, but the verify component is normally realized by generating the MAC, again, the MAC tag, and comparing it to the one that is attached, or the one that's given. And there's not much space of how to do this, like of different ways of doing this, right? So there's only one test condition that this happens there. And secondly, when the only example we could think of where you could have a MAC that returns multiple errors was the Geezer library example, where the implementation of the MAC was implemented in a very bad way, that it was verifying the MAC tag byte by byte, and the adversary was able to distinguish which byte and in which position the first MAC was different from the expected MAC. However, this results in the MAC itself being insecure. So there's not much you can say about security if the component you're using or the primitive you're using is not secure. So it seems a fair assumption to assume that the MAC only returns one single error. Okay, so in summary, we proposed the multiple error settings in order to account for distinguished decryption failures in our security models, and hence obtain security guarantees that are more relevant to practice, that then are less dependent on the implementation. So, and this can be used two main ways. For example, we can use it in a preventive approach. So whenever we propose a scheme, we can assign different learned symbols to each check that appears in the decryption algorithm, and then prove it secure under this assumption. So then we have security which is less implementation dependent, and is less prone to being secure when implemented. Alternatively, we can use it to look at schemes that are already out there and try to model them and see if they are still secure if an adversary is able to distinguish between different decryption failures. So that concludes my talk, and thank you very much.
Any questions?